turning back. No turning back. This is my heart cry, though none go with me. The cross before me, the world behind me. This is my heart cry, though none go with me. The cross before me, the world behind me. I will follow you. My life for your fame, my every move bring glory to your name. This is my anthem, my life for your fame, my every move bring glory to your name. I will follow you. I will follow the cross before me, the world behind me. I will follow the cross before me, the world behind me. I will follow the cross before me, the world behind me. I will follow. No turning back. 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 Savior of sinners, soon returning. You are Lord, you are Lord, you reign eternally. You are Lord God Almighty, my Savior and my King. You are Lord, you are Lord, you reign eternally. You are Lord God Almighty, my Savior and my King. Holy, 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 man hath fallen from thee. Through the blood of Christ thy Son, this soul can be redeemed. Justice, truth, and mercy join with love to crown thee, Savior of sinners, soon returning.
Amen. I want to invite you to be seated. Yeah, it's built off such a wonderful hymn. And it's built off an image in the first few verses of that. It focuses on the incredible scene of worship in the book of Revelation. We find it in the last chapters. Can you imagine watching everybody that is before the Lord God, and all they want to do is bow down and worship and celebrate Him as holy? I think of that image of worship, and I think about that as we come together this day. To have that be the only time, have all the worries, all of the things that might have consumed our day, all of the busyness, all of the chaos that might have consumed it. I don't know, maybe I'm projecting some of my day on you. But I think sometimes we get into all of those things that consume us in the course of our daily life. And when we come to worship, I pray that we can lay those down. That we can be wholly present with God, where we're coming together and singing praises unto the Lord our God is what stirs our heart and reminds us that we come to worship, that we can be like those who will worship in heaven in the revelation, and that all that goes on in this world, it's going to keep on going on day after day. We are going to have high days, we're going to have low days, we're going to have everything in between. We're going to have mountaintops and we're going to have plateaus, but in the midst of it all, God is still God. He is on the throne, and He never fails in loving us, in pursuing us, in wanting to bring restoration into our life. Gracious Lord and God, we love You. Lord, to come into this place, to be together in a time in which, yes, Lord, we come to worship. We aren't spectators, Lord. We are looking upon You, we examine our lives, all the wondrous ways in which You bless us, in which You strengthen us and guide us each day. And we just want to give You thanks and praise. We want to give You all the glory. Because, Lord, we know that if we had to manage this life on our own, by our own strength, with our own wits and our own ways, Lord, we would be overwhelmed. But, Lord, we can come and we can come into this place where we can encourage one another, build one another up. We can come into this time where we turn and focus upon You and remember that our life is not defined by the things that we do or the frustrations that we face, but our life is shaped by You and You alone. That You give us meaning, You give us purpose, and that ultimately Your desire for us is to be united with You for all eternity. Lord, we aren't trying to hasten that day. but we look forward to the time when we will be with you face to face, where we will worship you with eyes wide open. We love you, Lord. Draw us deeper into worship this day. We pray in your holy name. Amen. Well, this is a big week in the life of the church. It's the week in which we celebrate Pentecost, and for a lot of folks, they hear that word, and that's just a big Christian word that the church uses, and pastors will get up and say, oh, we're celebrating Pentecost, and I always wonder, it's like, are half the people in the listening thinking, what is that? Well, we know the word penta. We do geometry, and we get the Pentagon, or we look into Washington and see that strange building there. We call it the Monument to Murphy's Law, you know, four walls and a spare. You never know quite which way you're going, but the element of Pentagon, we go to Pentecost, and Pentecost is actually a word out of Greek that means 50. It's that simple. And so we decide to use this word Pentecost because it is 50 days after the resurrection of our Savior in which we're celebrating the receiving of the Holy Spirit. It's a promise that Jesus made to us, and we're going to walk into those scriptures this day. It's a promise that every single one of us who are believers would receive the Holy Spirit. I want to talk a little bit about one of the ways in which the Holy Spirit fills us, and that is how the Holy Spirit gifts us with specific gifts. I'm going to tell you, I'll share with you a little bit about my life, and I know I'm going to start off with something that you might think that, I don't know, whether I'm fibbing to you or you just find it a little unbelievable. But speaking in front of me, this is already happening. Speaking in front of people petrifies me. No, you're sitting there saying, you don't look petrified, you don't look terrified, you don't look, but as I get more acclimated to people, it becomes a little easier, but the anxiety is always there. There's always that little bit of fear, that little bit of anxiousness, that little bit of nervousness that is there, but that is nothing like it was in the beginning. Back when I was growing up, and you might say, oh, it's just when I was a kid, and I was shy, and I was withdrawn, but I did not talk to anybody. I worked in my parents' hardware store, and I'd have customers, you know, I'd try to help them, and it'd be kind of like, can I help you today? And they didn't even know what I said. I mean, they assumed I must have greeted them somehow and asked them if I could assist them. But, I mean, I was just very, very, very quiet. If you saw me walking the other way on a street, you know, it's like, I'm going to put my head down. I didn't enter into a conversation. So, okay, maybe that's my shyness. But then, you know, I moved out. I was, you know, I went off to college. I was pursuing engineering, and then I felt this call to go into teaching. And I thought, well, I can do this. They're younger. I can deal with that. It's a lot of, you know, it's a bunch of people in a room, but I can deal with this. And I managed that. But when the Lord called me to be involved in ministry, that scared me. And I did everything I could to alter the situation so that I didn't have to do it. And I actually was at a young adult conference at one point, and I saw this group that was going out into the mission field, and they were actually teaching school subjects out of the mission field, and they could do some of that one-to-one sharing their faith, and I'm like, that really appealed to me. And I knew that's not what the Lord was calling me to, but I decided that's what the Lord was going to call me to. So I'm going to orient this in my direction because that's where I was comfortable. And the idea of preaching up in front of people absolutely terrified me. I'll never forget the first time that it happened. My mentor, Eric Worley, invited me to preach at his church. And at first I was like, wow, I mean, what an incredible honor. You know, it's like, and I worked on it for I don't even know how many weeks. And we got to the week that it was happening and I started to have questions and I kind of put out little things out there. Was, are you sure you want me to do this? And well, then I got to him Saturday, and I was like, I don't think I can do this. I think you need to preach. And he goes, well, God didn't give me the message this week. He gave it to you. I'm like, no, like you do this all the time. You got to have one, like, in the hopper that's just sitting there. It's like, he goes, God gave you the message this week. You got to trust him to equip you. And I said, I'm so nervous. I mean, I don't know how a word's going to come out of my mouth because I know how I got in front of people. Speech class in college was torture. And I don't know how I made it through it, but the idea of being in front of a congregation of 100 and some people absolutely terrified me. I was like, I don't think I can do this. And he looked and he shared with me something that absolutely shocked me. He said, every Sunday when I get up to preach, I'm a little nervous. And I looked at him and I was like, you got to be kidding me. You don't seem nervous at all. And he goes, I sweat behind the knees. He goes, and I'm like, okay, nobody's going to know that. And he says, but I know it. And he goes, and I feel like everybody can see it. And I feel like everybody can see my knees kind of trembling a little bit. And I was like, you don't tremble? And he goes, you don't know what's going on inside. He goes, I feel like my body's trembling a little bit. I'm like, how do you do that? Like, you know, I mean, I'm sitting there thinking I'm not going to be able to talk. And he said, if you think you got it all together when you step up there, then there's way too much of you and none of God involved in it. But if you have that little bit of nervousness, that little bit of anxiousness that's there, in which you can't produce this, that's the kind of dependence that you need. That was a tough day when I did preach. I did it. I did it twice that day. I don't know how. By the grace of God, amen. But the idea of me preaching still was beyond belief. It just, it baffled me. They got me to take a spiritual gifts inventory. And if you've never taken one of those, it's very entertaining when you sit there and you get down to this thing and it says, your gifts are prophecy, exhortation, faith, and preaching. I didn't even know what that first one really was. I knew what a prophet was, but I didn't understand how you could have a gift of prophecy and exhortation. I'm like, what the world is that? I mean, that's a big Christianese word for encouragement, which you can do in preaching, you can do in personal conversations, you can do it. And I was like, oh, okay, well, maybe I've got that. And then as I began to discover it, it's not something that you say, okay, I've accomplished this, or I've trained myself in this. It is indeed a gift of the Holy Spirit. It's not something that we figure out how to get good at. It's not something that we, in fact, so often our spiritual gifts are something in which when we look into ourselves, we initially may have a deep hesitancy because we don't have the background or the training or the natural ability or whatever it is that would give us the confidence in ourselves. But rather, this is a gifting the Spirit has given us that we're challenged to step into or to press into and say, okay, Lord, if you've said that you have placed this in me, then I am going to use this for your glory. And it scares the bejeebies out of me to think about doing this because I don't have any background, any anchoring in myself where I think I've got this. Now, every once in a while, you do have a gift where, like, one of my gifts that is not up in the very top, but is that of teaching. Well, I also had a lot of training in teaching. So sometimes you have both a gift and you have some training, and it's kind of those two things can go together and bring forth a greater strength. But one of the things that I looked at in preaching, even as I got to my early churches, I mean, it was like every Sunday I got up there, and instead of trusting wholly in that gift, I mean, I did all the preparation, I did all the stuff, I stepped up in, you know, into the pulpit, I delivered that message, and then I went home and I beat on myself. I was so incredibly critical and condemning, and I would just excuse everything. If somebody tried to praise me or thank me for the message that I gave to them, I would dismiss it. I got called out by Eric on that because basically he said, you're taking somebody else's gift of praise in which they're wanting to celebrate what God is doing in you, and you're silencing them and you're not allowing them to have it, and that hurt. That hurt. But all I could see was where I was falling short, because what eyes was I looking through? And this is what I think we do so often as in our spiritual gifts. I'm looking through the eyes of my assessment of how well I'm using it, and what am I using as my gauge? I'm not using the gauge of saying, okay, am I serving the purpose and doing what God has called me to do? I'm using the gauge of somebody else who I see uses that gift and does it better than me. And I look at all the ways that I fall short. And I think it's one of the reasons why in the church so many people think about their spiritual gifts, if they're even aware of them, they pull back, they don't use them, they think there's somebody better, there's somebody more equipped, there's somebody, but it's like God has gifted you and God has gifted you for that purpose. Coming face to face with that in my life, that God had gifted me with the gift of preaching, and that it wasn't going to be Cliff saying, I'm going to go down my own path, I'm going to navigate my own way, I'm going to go into the mission field, I'm going to go where I'm comfortable, and I'm going to spend all my time trying to convince God that he's wrong in his vision for my life so that I can be comfortable with using my gifts my way. That's not honorable to the way that he has gifted us. So I want to get into this a little bit, and the idea of how does this affect your lives? Are there gifts that you have that you've pressed into and you've been, you know, it's like maybe it's been something that's been awkward or it's been difficult, or maybe you've been kind of very self-critical like I was, or maybe it's something that you pressed into and you found just this rich wonder, this incredible amazement, this like this fire inside of you that you didn't know quite how to describe. Maybe it even scared you a little bit because you didn't understand it, didn't understand where it was coming from or why it was coming from there. There's a lot of things that we experience. And so I want to dig into some scripture tonight. We're actually going to dig into quite a bit, and we want to talk about the work of the Holy Spirit, because that is where these gifts come from. When Jesus left, he said, I'm not going to leave you orphan. I'm going to tell the Father, and he is going to send another. And the other that he's going to send has a lot of different roles in your life. We're going to talk about more of those in the coming weeks. Got a lot of different roles in your life, but this one, I want you to know, is about placing particular gifts in your life, and there's a particular reason for placing them there. So let's dig into Luke 3. It says, when all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, you are my son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased. So when Jesus left his throne above, when he surrendered his divine power, he came into earth. He was born as a baby. He was born with that limitation that he placed on himself. And he had to face all of the human issues, all of the challenges that we face in that human strength. Except we have this element where the Holy Spirit was given to him. And so how did Jesus do what he did? By the power of the Holy Spirit in his life. So when we talk about the gifting, when we talk about his miracles, when we talk about his teaching, when we talk about his knowledge, his understanding, his wisdom, all of this is a gift of the Holy Spirit at work in him. Let's pick over into John 14, where it says, very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works that I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And so Jesus explains that there's something that's coming in which, you know, all the works that they have seen him do in the 2.5-3 years that he's been with them, now they are going to pick up, they are going to do. And they had to have wondered, how the world are we going to carry this out, because they've witnessed it. Let's continue on in John 14. Pick up in verse 16, it says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. And so this is the giving of the Holy Spirit to the church. And as I said, the Holy Spirit has many, many different purposes in our life. The Holy Spirit guides us. The Holy Spirit counsels us, convicts us. The Holy Spirit is that which binds us together as the people of God. But we're talking about the element in which the Holy Spirit gifts the church for a very specific purpose. So we're going to jump into the Apostle Paul. We'll find him in 1 Corinthians 12, and Paul begins to describe how the Holy Spirit gifts the church and why the Holy Spirit gifts the church. It says, now about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but all of them and in everyone is the same God at work. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. And so Paul ends that section right there. To each one, to all persons, every single person receives at least one of the gifts. He's prefacing it. We're going to continue on in 1 Corinthians in a moment. But he's prefacing it, and he's saying to each and every single person, there is given at least one of the gifts that he's going to get ready to talk about. And it is for the common good. What does that mean? It means for the building up of the church, for the maturing of the church. And it says that unless we have the Holy Spirit indwelling us, we can not truly confess that Jesus is Lord. Now, I want to step back and say, wait a second. I can confess Jesus is Lord. Well, you can say the words. But to truly confess Jesus is Lord, to have Jesus be the Lord of our life, means that we accept his lordship over the whole of who we are. It means that we surrender. It means that we sacrifice our right to be in charge of our life. We still live, we still make many decisions, but our first priority is to say, Lord, I want to live in accordance with your will. And I know I can't do that by my own strength because my flesh wants to sin. And only by your Holy Spirit, only by the leading of your Spirit, can I live a life that is holy and pleasing to you. Only by your Holy Spirit can I truly confess, you are my Lord, and I want to live under your lordship, under your leadership, under your protection, and under your guidance. So the Holy Spirit uses us as spiritual partners of the kingdom work for the common good, for the building up of the church. Well, listen to what Paul talks about in these gifts. It says, to one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by the means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. And to another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, the distinguishing between spirits. And to another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And still to another, the interpretation of tongues. All of these are the work of the one and the same Spirit. And he distributes them to each one. We hear those words again. To each one, just as he determines. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all of its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. He picks up a little later on in chapter 12, and he talks about a few more. He says, now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it, and God has placed in the church, first of all, apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, and then miracles, and then gifts of healing, of helping, of guidance, of different kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? And what Paul's trying to say is like, this is not a thing that you should examine in your life and say, oh, well, there's the 19 gifts in the Spirit. I got to examine which ones, you know, do I have all of them? No, there are specific gifts given to specific people for the edification and for the building up of the body. In other places, to the Ephesians, he adds in evangelists and pastors. And in Romans, he talks about leadership and mercy and serving and encouragement and generosity. So all of these gifts are things that the Holy Spirit pours out to us for the common good, for the building up of the body. And I am absolutely convicted and convinced that if the church is exercising those gifts, there is nothing that could stop the church. But if we take our gifts and we say, you know what, I'm going to hold them inside of myself, there's got to be somebody better, I don't want to know my gifts, I don't want to get involved in that, I want to run off to missionary camp so I can do it my way, I want to, you know, stay in my house, I want to stay in my comfort zone, I want to stay in my... If that is how we choose to live, then we cut off not only ourselves, but we cut off the whole church from what God is doing in us. I believe that if you launched a church and you had two of every kind of gift represented, you would see a church with explosive growth. You would see a church in which you had the Spirit just absolutely surging because everybody was sitting there and saying, I'm bringing forth my gift and I'm using it exactly how God has called me to use it. And I know that is continually opening up into new things every single day. And yet I have another person with my same gift, and what do? We're mutually encouraging each other. But the other thing that happens with gifts is that when we use them, it's not just us that transforms, it's not just the body that transforms, but it's those around us in the moment that get affected. The number of times I've come into a situation, I'm going to tell you, preaching is one of them. I have come into preaching, and maybe it's been something where my head's not in the right place, or maybe, you know, I just feel burdened that day, or kind of my heart's really not in it, and then I come in to the fellowship of the body, and some of the people are using their gifts. It might be a gift of encouragement. It might be and I had that tonight where I was kind of, I had my mind on other things. I wasn't here yet. And then I had some voices just come into me and bring some, you know, the spiritual gift of encouragement. And it begins to set a fire inside of me. And it begins to transform me. And that's what happens. When you use your spiritual gift, the people around you get affected and it affects their spiritual gift. But what happens when the body says, you know, I just want to worship. I just want to do my thing. I want to live in my comfort zone. I want to keep my spiritual gift to myself. We cut off the body from the fire. We talk about the Holy Spirit, and if you've seen this, often you see the image of the fire or of flames. It comes from an image out of early in Acts where tongues of fire came down and descended on the apostles. This image of that fire of God burning inside of us, that contagious fire that will consume. Friends, I pray that that would invade our lives and invade our church. Maybe you're thinking, well, Pastor, how do I figure out my spiritual gifts? Well, there's folks that have done some assessments that help you to discover it. And really, they just ask questions, and they kind of ask questions from a perspective, so they're not asking you, well, is your gift shepherding? They ask you things about experiences that you've had and kind of where your heart is driven. And so it may not even be something that you're practicing, but what happens when the Spirit inside of you, you know, experiences that situation, when you think about that circumstance, you're like, yeah, that's something I want to be a part of. People with the spirit of generosity, if you put a situation in which they have the opportunity to show generosity, you write that kind of a sentence, they read it and they're like, yeah, that's exactly what I would be involved in. And it begins to expose where your spiritual gifts are. I encourage you to get on our church website, because I've got it on an easy tab on the front page. And if you're not a website person, get a hold of me. I'll give you a print version. I want to take us into Ephesians 1. This is, again, the Apostle Paul. He's talking to the church in Ephesus. He says, "You also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory." I think of the number of conversations I've had over the years with people who say, I'm just not sure. I'm not sure I'll get into heaven if I die. I'm not sure God is with me. I don't feel him. Maybe even getting to the element of saying, you know, if God would just do one of those really impressive things, like he'd speak to me out loud, or he'd do like a miracle for me that feeds me, then I'd believe. But that's not really how belief happens, is it? Belief happens as we trust in him and we see him consistently at work day after day after day after day. And there is no greater place in our life in which we can see and experience that work firsthand than to embrace the gift that God has given us and to turn back to God and say, okay, Lord, you've gifted me with this. I'm going to press in. Lord, I don't see it. I'm not sure how the world you're going to use me for this. This is not my wheelhouse. This is not my natural talent. This is not my... But Lord, something inside of me, the Spirit speaks inside of me. When I answered those questions, it came up and it said, this is something that's at the core of what drives you. And so, Lord, if that's what you've put in me, then I'm going to trust you. Lord, if that's what you've put in me for the edification of the body, for the building up of the church and the maturing of the church and the maturing of our belief in you as our Lord, then, Lord, I'm going to press in and I'm going to offer it back to you. He has given us an incredible gift. Let us give back to the Lord our God. Let us see what he does with it. If I went my path, I wouldn't be here. And I will tell you that I haven't gotten over my fear. I go into circumstances with the people that I'm less familiar with an environment I'm less familiar with, or with situations at, say, a general conference meeting, when I think, I should get up and speak on this issue. My heart begins to beat faster, and I feel like it's going to jump out of my chest. My mouth begins to dry out, and I start going through the words in my head, and all I can think is, I'm going to get up there, and I'm going to be so nervous, and my heart's going to beat, and my mouth is going to be dry, and I'm going to fumble over my words, and I'm not going to say what I want to say, And the ability to talk myself out of it is still there. It's not quite preaching, but the element of being in front of a crowd still. It still terrifies me. I don't know if terrifies the right word, but it gets things beaten. It is difficult. But when I step up to preach, even if it starts off in a place where it's a little awkward, it's a little challenging, it's as I press into it, he meets me there and strengthens me. And I have watched him do times where I feel so ill-prepared, where I can't even see the message that he used me to write in preparation. And I think, well, this is going to fall flat today. I have come into worship with that mindset sometimes. This is going to fall flat because I can't see it. But by leaning into the gift and just saying, okay, Lord, and then something comes out that has nothing to do with me because it goes so far beyond words on a page. Friends, if we press in with the gifts that he has placed in us, he will bless the church and he will bless us. And the evidence that he is at work in us, the evidence that he is with us, the confidence that we can have, that know that deposit that he said is in us, is in us. And that when we confess Christ as our Lord, we'll confess it with conviction because we know he lives in us. God is good, my friends, and he loves us. And he did not leave us abandoned. He gave us a precious gift. Gracious Lord and God, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for, we're amazed, Lord, that you choose to partner with us. Lord, with all of our flaws, with all of the directions that we choose, with all of our rebellion, with all of our resistance, with all of the ways that we crave our own comfort and our own mindset, Lord, you continue to pursue us and pour into us. And Lord, you desire to build up your church through relationships, one to the next to the next. And so, Lord, we pray for the courage and for the strength and for a willing heart to discover the gifts that you have placed in us. To press into them. By the leading of your Spirit, Lord. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, have been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. Word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun.